Welcome students, today we will learn about the formation of a company as per Companies Act of 1956. Let us try to understand what is the meaning of a formation of a company. Formation of a company generally is the process of registering a business as a limited company at a company's house. As a result, the business becomes a distinct legal entity. The process is also referred as company incorporation and company registration. The formation of a company is a very lengthy process. For our convenience, let us try to understand the whole process of company formation as it can be divided into four stages. First stage, it is a promotion stage. Second stage, incorporation or registration stage. Stage 3, capital subscription stage. Stage 4, commencement of business stage. So let us understand each of these various stages of a formation of a company. Stage 1, that is promotion stage. Promotion is the first stage in the formation of a company. The term promotion refers to the aggregate of activities designed to bring in being an enterprise to operate a business. It presupposes the technical processing of a commercial proposition with reference to its potential probability. The meaning of promotion and the steps to be taken in promoting a business are discussed in brief at the later stage of this lecture. Stage 2, incorporation or registration. Incorporation or registration is the second stage in the formation of a company. It is the registration that brings a company into existence. A company is properly constituted only when it is duly registered under the Act and a certificate of incorporation has been obtained from the registrar of companies. The next stage is stage number 3, capital subscription stage. A private company or a public company not having share capital can commence business immediately on its incorporation. As such, capital subscription stage and commencement of business stage are relevant only in case of a public company having a share capital. Such a company has to pass through these additional two stages before it can commence the business. Stage 4, commencement of business stage. After getting the certificate of incorporation, a private company can start its business. A public company can start its business only after getting a certificate of commencement of business. Now let us look at the documents to be filed with the registrar of companies before going ahead with the incorporation of a company. The application for registration of a company should be presented to the registrar of companies of the state in which the business office of the company is to be situated. The application shall be accompanied with the documents that are, first one, the memorandum of association, second document that is important, the articles of association, if any, duly signed by the subscribers of the memorandum. Point number 3, a statement of the nominal or authorized capital. Point number 4, a notice of address of the registered office of the company. This may be done within 30 days of registration if it cannot be filed at the time of registration. Point number 5, a list of directors and their consent to act as such, signed by each. Point number 6, an undertaking in writing signed by each such director to take and pay for their qualification shares. Point Point number 7, a declaration that all the requirements of the Companies Act have been complied with. Such a declaration may be signed by an advocate of a Supreme Court or a High Court, an attorney or pledger entitled to appear before a High Court, or a chartered accountant practicing in India who is engaged in the formation of the company, or by a person named in the articles as director, manager or secretary of the company. The point number 5 and 6 that I mentioned a while ago are not required to be filed in case of a private company. If the registrar is satisfied that all the requisite documents delivered to him are in order, he shall register the memorandum and the articles, if any, provided he is satisfied on some more points, such as the relevant provisions of the Act have been complied with, the objects of the company are lawful, the requisite number of persons required under the Act have subscribed and duly signed, the memorandum and the articles comply in all respect with the provisions of the Act, the name selected by company is acceptable, and the statutory declaration has been properly made. If the registrar of companies is satisfied that all the aforesaid requirements have been complied with, he will register the company and place its name on the registrar of the companies. It is clear that once the statutory requirements have been complied with, the registrar has no option but no register it. On refusal to register a company on improper grounds, he may be compelled by writ of mandus. Next point that we are going to discuss is certificate of incorporation. On registration, the registrar will issue a certificate of incorporation whereby he certifies that the company is incorporated. From the date of incorporation mentioned in the certificate, the company becomes legal person separate from its shareholders and secures a perpetual succession. Hence, it is the birth certificate of the company. The certificate of incorporation prevents the reopening of matter prior to the registration and places the existence of the company as a legal person beyond doubt. Consequently, if the 7 signatures of a memorandum were written by one person or were all forged, the certificate would be conclusive that the company was duly registered. Similarly, if the signatories were all infant, the certificate would still be conclusive. Next point that we are going to discuss is about certificate of commencement of business. A private company may commence its business immediately on incorporation, but a public company cannot commence business immediately after incorporation unless it has obtained a certificate of commencement of business, also known as a trading certificate. This certificate has to be obtained from the registrar of companies. If the company has a share capital and has issued a prospectus inviting the public to subscribe for its shares or debentures, it cannot commence business until shares payable in cash have been allotted to the extent of the minimum subscription, or every director has paid in cash the application and allotment money on the shares taken by him, or no money is liable to be repaid to the application for failure to apply or obtain permission for the shares or debentures to be dealt in on any recognized stock exchanges. A statutory declaration duly verified by one of the directors or secretary in the prescribed form that the above conditions have been complied, which has been filed with the registrar. Now let us move on and try to understand promoter. In the beginning of this lecture, I gave you some information about the promoter. Let us understand the details of a promoter now. A promoter is one who undertakes to form a company with reference to a given object and to set it going, and who takes the necessary steps to accomplish that purpose. The promoter of a company decides the scope of its business activities. They negotiate, if necessary, for the purchase of an existing business. They instruct the solicitors to prepare the necessary documents and secure the services of the director. They provide the registration fees and carry out other duties involved in the formation of a company. They also make arrangement for advertising and circulating the prospectus and placing the capital. A promoter is not an agent for a company which he is forming, because a company cannot have an agent before it comes into existence. For the same reason, he cannot be the trustee of the company. However, from the moment he acts with the company in mind, a promoter stands in fiduciary position towards the company. Now, let us understand liabilities of promoters. A promoter can be compelled by company to hand over any secret profit which he had made without full disclosure to the company. The company can also sue for rescission of the contract of sale by promoter where the promoter has not disclosed his interest therein. A promoter is liable for any untrust statement in the prospectus to a person who has subscribed for any shares or debentures on the faith of prospectus. Such a person may sue the promoter for compensation for any loss or damage sustained by him. Next point is about remuneration of promoters. The nature of a promoter's work in the formation of a company calls for considerable skills for which he should be adequately remunerated. A promoter has no right against the company for his remuneration unless there is a contract to that effect. In the absence of such a contract, he can even recover from the company payments he has made in connection with the formation of the company. The next most important topic in the formation of company that we are going to study today is of memorandum of association and articles of association. So what is the meaning of memorandum of association? Memorandum of association is one of the core documents which has to be filed with the registrar of companies at the time of incorporation of a company. It is a document which sets out the constitution of the company and relay the foundation on which the structure of the company is based. It contains the fundamental conditions upon which alone the company is allowed to be incorporated. A company may pursue only such objects and exercise only such powers as are conferred expressly in the memorandum or by implication thereof. That is, such power as are indicated to the attainment of the objective. A company cannot depart from the provisions contained in its memorandum. However, greater the necessity may be, if it does, it would be ultra vires that company, and therefore wholly void. It defines its relation with the outside world and the scope of its activities. The purpose of memorandum is to enable shareholders, creditors, and those who deal with the company to know what is the permitted range of activities of the enterprise. The next point that we are going to understand is the contents of the memorandum of association. According to section 13, the memorandum of association of every company must contain some of the clauses such as the name of the company with limited as the last word of the name in case of public limited company and with private limited as the last word in case of a private limited company. Point number two, the state in which the registered office of the company is to be situated. Point number three, the objects of the company is to be classified as the main objective of the company to be pursued by the company on its incorporation and objective incidental to the attainment of the main objective and other objectives not included in the above. Point number four, the liability of member is limited if the company is limited by shares or by guarantee. Point number five, in case of a company having a share capital, the amount of the share capital with which the company proposes to be registered and its division into shares of a fixed amount. An unlimited company need not include any of the last two points that are mentioned in the memorandum of association. Next point, alteration to the memorandum of association. The memorandum of association is a company being its charter. The rights of the company to alter its content is rigidly limited by provisions of the Act. Section 16 of the Act provides that a company shall not alter the conditions contained in the memorandum except in the case of the matters and to the extent provided in the Act. So some of the alterations that are permitted in the memorandum are listed on the screen, like change of name, change of registered office, change of object clauses, change of liability clauses, change of capital clauses. Let us try to understand these points one by one. Change of name. A company can change its name for this purpose. It must first pass a special resolution and then obtain approval of the central government in writing. However, no such approval is necessary for merely including or deleting the word private. Consequent conversion of public company into private company and vice versa. The registrar shall enter the new name, the registrar, in place of the former name and shall issue a fresh certificate or incorporation. Necessarily, alteration shall also be made in the memorandum by the registrar. The change of name shall be complete and effective only on the issue of such a certificate. The rights and obligations of a company will not be affected on the change of its name as per Section 23 of Companies Act of 1956. Change of registered office. A company can shift its registered office from one place to another within the same city, town or village, provided a notice of change is given to the registrar within 30 days of such change. But where the registered office is to be changed outside the local limits of any city, town or village in the same state, special resolution to that effect must be passed. However, the alteration of the change of the place of the registered office of a company from one state to another shall take effect only on the confirmation by the National Law Tribunal on petition. A notice of such change shall also be given to the registrar within 30 days of the changes. These two changes in the registered office do not involve alteration of memorandum. Change of object clause. Section 17 of the Act only gives a limited right to the company to alter its object clause. This section provides a specific purpose that the object clause can be altered only if the change enables the company to carry on its business more economically or more efficiently, to attain its main objective by new or improved means, to enlarge or change the local area of its operations, to carry on some business which under existing circumstances may be conveniently or advantageously combined with the business of the company, to restrict or to abandon any of the objects specified in the memorandum, to sell or dispose of the whole or any part of the undertaking of the company, or to amalgamate with any other company or body of the person. The next point that we are going to understand is about change of a liability clause. Ordinarily, the liability clause cannot be altered so as to make the liability of the members unlimited. Any alteration in the memorandum will be void if the effect of the alteration is the enhancement of the liability of the members. This provision, however, will not apply to a case where the members agree in writing to be bound by the alteration. A limited company, if authorized by its articles by a special resolution, may alter its memorandum to make the liability of its directors or manager unlimited. This rule applies to future appointees only. Such alteration will, however, not affect the existing directors and managers unless they have accorded their consent. This is as per section 323 of Companies Act. The next point that we are going to understand is about change of the capital clause. A limited company having a share capital may alter its capital clause subject to the provisions of its articles by a resolution in the general meeting. The confirmation of the court is not required if the alteration is not made for any of the purposes such as to increase its share capital or to consolidate and divide its capital into shares of large amount, to convert its fully paid shares into stock or reconvert the stock into fully paid up shares, to subdivide its shares into share of a smaller amount, and to cancel its shares. But for reduction of share capital, special resolution and confirmation by the court are necessary. Let us understand the next part, that is Articles of Association. This is also one of the most important document that has to be filed with the Registrar of Companies. So let us understand what is the meaning of Articles of Association. The word articles means the articles of association of a company as originally framed or as altered from time to time in pursuance of any provisions, company law or of this act. The articles of association are the rules and regulations of the company framed for the purpose of internal management of its affairs. It deals with the right of the member of the company. The articles are framed for carrying out the aim and objective of memorandum of association. The articles of association of a company are subordinate to or controlled by the Memorandum of Association. Some of the contents of Articles of Association are listed on the screen. There are 22 points that are listed, which talks about the composition of articles of association. Next, what is the basic difference between the memorandum and the articles? That is, memorandum of association and the articles of association. If we just look at content and scope, the memorandum of association is a chapter of a company and defines its scope of its activities. Whereas articles of association of a company is a document which regulates the internal management of the company. There are rules made by the company for carrying out the objects of a company as set out in the memorandum of association. The next important distinction is with relation to relationship between company members and outsiders. Memorandum of association defines the retention of a company with the outside world, whereas articles of association deals with the rights of the members of a company and also establishes the relationship of the company with the members. Next one is about alteration. Memorandum of association cannot be altered except in the manner and to the extent provided by the act, whereas the articles, being only the bylaw of the company, can be altered by special resolutions. Supremacy. Memorandum is a supreme document of the company, whereas articles are subordinate to the memorandum. They cannot be altered or controlled or control the memorandum. Next important point is adoption. Every company must have its own memorandum, but a company limited by shares need not register its articles. Next important point is Ultravirus Act. A company cannot depart from the provisions contained in its memorandum, and if it does, it would be ultravirus the company. Anything done against the provisions of articles but which is inter vires the memorandum can be rectified. Thanks for watching this video on formation of the company as per Companies Act of 1956. Please like, share and subscribe this channel.